this much time it has taken. Okay, fine, students. So we are about to study this topic called the comma operator. See, plainly, if we discuss by taking a slide content mentioned theoretically like this, it will become difficult for us to recognize what we are learning. Okay, let's take an example of a program and then we'll understand this comma operator. Comma operator, basically, just we are trying to understand what is the meaning behind this comma in our C language. Okay, see, it has got two meanings. One is very simple. For example, I'll declare one variable as char ch, and I also feel that I need to declare some other variable as well of the same type as char. Okay, so I can mention comma between these two variables and then I can write this as both as character data type. Okay, character data type. The same way, the same meaning, like how we are finding or using the comma in our usual natural language, that is English. In usual English language, how we are using this comma, the same meaning gets applied here in this place as well. Okay, very simple. Character ch is a variable name and that is of type char, and instead of this is one way. Okay, this is one way of declaring everything in a single line. Okay, the other way of the same declaration is char ch. Okay, this time we are declaring only the ch as a one variable of type char, and next time we can declare temp of type character. Okay, so like this. So what happens here, we have consumed two lines of code, that's it, nothing else. So we can merge or we can combine both the declarations of ch and temp, because they both are character type only. So we can combine both of them and then declare in a single line like this. Okay, so this is the usual way of declaring a multiple variables of the same data type. Okay, so these are all one variable, temp is another variable. In case if we want to use another variable, we can declare everything, but we need to separate it with the comma of those variables, and then we need to finally mark the variable data type. Okay, so any glitches in the voice, students? Any glitches in my voice or any disturbances happening in my voice delivery or the video delivery in your terminal?
No, fine, sir. Everything fine.
So this is the one benefit, students. This is the one benefit that by using comma, we can declare multiple variables, but they all have to be of the same data type. We can declare multiple variable by placing a comma in between them. Okay, but all those variables should be of a similar type, then only we can put a comma and then we can write. Okay, so that is the one benefit. Next benefit, see, this variable comma, when it is in use within the expression. Okay, for example, I. Okay, let's declare I as a int I equal to x is assigned with the 10 and y is assigned with the 20. Look at here. I hope by this time it would be visible in your terminal. Look at here, I have declared a variable of type integer and I is one variable, okay, of integer type. Now to this I am assigning a value. So what value I am assigning a two values here. Okay, this is one value and this is another value. Okay, this is permissible in our C language, but of course such kind of assignments and all nowhere in use in real time. Okay, this is for our understanding. Specifically in the competitive exams, they will give such kind of a confusing question and they will try to confuse us. Okay, simply remember, by using comma, whenever we are trying to assign a multiple values to a single variable. So look at here, these two values and we are trying to assign to this variable I. So whenever we try to do the same or more than one value to a single variable, the leftmost value alone will get assigned to the variable that we are trying to assign. Okay, Y value will not be taken into consideration. This is the second point that we need to understand. Okay, see, where I started is, we can try to assign two values to one single variable, but in such situation, only one value will be assigned to the variable what we are dealing with. okay, next will be simply discarded. Okay, I'm telling you that this is only for the purpose of confusing in the competitive exam point of view. Okay, for the theoretical exam or the university exam point of view, we need to have an idea that more than one value can be assigned to a variable, but at the end only the leftmost value, that is x is equal to 10, that is value 10 only will be assigned to the variable I. Okay, so this is the 2 point that we should understand for the comma operator. Okay, now let's take the program example and then we'll understand. Okay, the required header file is stdio.h main. Okay, look at here, int I j, we are declaring two variable I j. Okay, then I is equal to, look at here, the same way that I have used here, I is equal to j equal to 10 and j plus 20. Okay, so what happened here? What happened here? Two things are happening here. Okay, so what is that? I is assigned with two value. Okay, two value, that is the first value and this is the second value. Okay, but compiler will take only the leftmost value that we have tried to assign. So as a result, the leftmost value is j equal to 10, that is value 10. That value 10 only will be assigned to I. Okay, so I am just for our understanding purpose, I am writing that I value will be assigned with the 10. Okay, now this expression says that j is equal to 10. Okay, listen very carefully, this first expression says that j is equal to 10. J is assigned with the value 10. This first expression says that j is 10. So immediately after this execution of this first portion of the expression, it comes to the second portion of the expression. In the second portion of the expression, j plus 20, which means already j contains 10, with the 10, 20 gets added to it. So if this gets added, it will again, that added value will again get stored in the same j only. So as a result, j will get 30 as the value. Okay, so in a single expression like this, I equal to j equal to 10 comma j plus 20, like this, in single expression we have got two assignments to a two variable. One is I is getting the leftmost value, as well as j is indirectly assigned with the value 10, and that value 10 gets added with the 20, and as a result j gets the accumulated value as 30. Okay, now when we execute this program, this printf statement, it will print the output like this. Okay, I am writing the output here, look at here, you can guess the output. Now I equal to will come as such, in the place of percentage d, it will pick up the element that is given in the first argument here. Okay, so what is the value of I that gets printed for the first percentage d, that is percentage, sorry, 10. I have got the value as a 10, so in the place of percentage d, 10 gets displayed. Then by the usage of a slash n, my cursor will go and blink in the next line. Okay, then j is equal to, so in my place, next line I will print j is equal to will come as such, in the place of percentage d, the value of j will get placed here. Okay, the value of j is accumulated to 30. Okay, so these two value will get printed. This is the output of this program. Okay, take a look at this, students, take a look at this. You understand the first point, that comma operator can be used to declare multiple variables of the same type by placing comma in between them. And next point is, whenever we try to assign a complexly the values to one variable, the leftmost value only will be assigned to the variable, and we may the compiler will discard the right hand side variable. But here this is with respect to the example that I have written. Okay, but here the same variable here has got j, so automatically here j will get added with whatever the initial value is assigned with, that is 10 plus 20, and then the output comes like this. So in this example, that is manually I have written, no, in this second example, in this example nothing happens, only I will get the value as a 10. Okay, it happens like this, I will get the value as 10 and x remains as 10 only, because we have assigned x with the 10, and y will remain have a value as 20 only. Okay, nothing happens. Okay, so in a single statement here in this example, I have assigned three variables with the value. Okay, that's all, students. It is very simple to understand, but remember that whenever we are assigning more than one value to a variable, leftmost value only will be assigned. Rest everything will be kept as such. Fine. Is it clear? Let's move to the next operator, arrow operator. Okay. To better understand this arrow operator, we need to study a concept called a pointer. Okay. Pointer. Okay. There is a concept in our C language called a pointer. It is nothing but a mechanism or a programming technique by which we can declare one variable of some data type that can store the address. Okay. Look at here. Simply for our easy understanding, for now I am declaring one variable int a equal to 10. Okay, simply I am declaring, as well as I am initializing this a with the value 10. So as soon as our compiler comes and scans this line, it comes to know that there is a variable a, and that variable has got some memory allocated to it, and in that memory allocated value, it is stored with the value 10, and the memory will have some address location, that is, let's say 1000. Okay, so variable a has got some memory space in our computer memory, and that memory will be identified by the address of that memory. Okay, let's say that address is 1000, and in that 1000th location our data, that is 10, will get initialized. Okay, now what is the concept of pointer, sir? Now I want to compute, or I want to store this address of the variable a. If I require to manipulate the address from where he is coming from, for example, if we want to do some survey, or if we are trying to do some statistical study of our college students in our campus, consider the situation that we try to see how many students are from which states. Okay, let's say, for example, from Tamil Nadu, so around 3000 students are studying. From states of Andhra Pradesh, around 4000 students are studying. So basically, we are trying to classify from which locations they are coming from. Okay, so similarly, A has got its value stored in which location. If the question arises like that, then we need to have a separate variable that is capable of storing the address of integer data type. So this 1000 needs to be stored in some variable, and that have to be declared separately. As, for example, I may declare ADDR, okay, short form of address. Okay, I may declare this variable ADDR, but prefix to it I need to put a star mark. Okay, I need to put a star special symbol. So this denotes that in the ADDR now I can able to store a 1000 as the address, and this 1000 is storing data of integer. Okay, this 1000th memory location is storing a data integer, so we need to declare what type of data gets stored in that particular address. That needs to be declared in this place. Okay, the way of declaring a pointer is like this. Okay, first we need to write the variable with to which we are trying to store the address. Then we need to prefix it with the star to denote that it is a variable capable of handling an address, not the simple data. It is wider than the data type. Okay, it can able to hold an address, number one. And number two, and that address is capable of holding what type of data? In this place, it is 10, that is a round number. It is not having any fraction. So we need to write a integer. In case if it stores, let's say, for example, 10.5. If it is the fraction value like this, then better we can write that as a float data type, because we are storing in the actual location of 1000, we are storing a float. Okay, we are storing a fraction number, so we need to mention that as a float. Okay, so like this the pointer concepts comes. So for having a better understanding of this arrow operator, we need to study about this pointer concepts in detail, and then we can study about this arrow operator. Okay, Until then, we cannot have a better understanding about the array operator. See, once after declaring and storing all the value of the address in this ADDR, we can able to pinpoint that location. We can able to pinpoint that location, what is the data present in that memory address. Okay, we for doing such kind of operation, arrow operator is very much used. Okay, so for now, understand up to this much, that to understand this concept of an arrow operator, we require to understand pointer concepts, and as well as there is also one more topic called structure, enum, like that. Okay, so we need to understand these both the topics very well. Then if I talk about the arrow operator, it will be easy for us to understand. Okay, so for now, I'll give a simple glimpse of this concept called a structure. If you're understanding, okay. If you're not understanding also, fine. Why? Because we are going to take up this each individual topic separately, and we'll be studying in detail. Okay, see, so far we have declared int a b sum. Okay, look at here, we are using a comma operator between the variables. Okay, like this we have declared. So what is the meaning here? A is also integer, b is also integer, sum is also integer. Okay, but let's say char grade and first, simply first name or first letter. Okay, so these two are capable of, or these two are the variables in which we can store only one character at a time. Okay, one character at a time. So now I require to store both of them together in one single variable. If I want to declare both the different data types in single variable, I cannot able to do. There is no proper direct way of declaring two different data types. One is capable of storing only number, other is capable of storing only character. We cannot able to merge both the things together, and then we cannot declare one single data type. But we can merge under one common name called a structure, and then we can define multiple data types together. So that concept is structure. So once after studying this structure and pointer, we will come back again to this arrow operator. Okay, for now you simply understand that this is an operator used to pinpoint the specific data type of integer, of character, of pointer, like that. Okay, if these variables are members of the structure, if the variables are members of the pointer, then we can able to access them by using the arrow operator. So that much you understand now. For detailed explanation, we will take up this topic in the coming chapters, and then we will learn that. Okay, everything is fine, students? Okay, moving ahead, we are moving to learn the next operator that is given in our syllabus as assignment operator. Okay, it is the next topic that we have to study, assignment operator. Very simple. See, the equal symbol, look at here, x is equal to 10. Okay, the meaning here is 10 value is being assigned to the variable x. So this is what called an assignment operator is. So similarly, we can assign, for example, x plus y is equal to 10. Okay, wherever the expression comes, and in that expression, if there is an equal symbol like this, if there is an equal symbol pointing to some value, then it denotes that this value on the right hand side is being assigned to this total expression. Okay, that is the meaning. That means this x plus y is equal to 10. So this equal symbol is called an assignment operator. Okay, this is very normal way of writing the assignment operator. But there is one topic called compound assignment. Compound assignment. The term denotes that the same assignment symbol, that is equal symbol, will come, but together we will have some complex things mentioned along with it. Okay, look at here. So what I'm going to do, along with this x, I would like to add along with the x value, that is a 10, I would like to add a 2. So if I wish to do that, what I can do, x is equal to x plus to, I want everybody to listen very carefully here, x is equal to x plus 2. X is equal to x plus 2. If I write like this, what happens? In the place of x, already we have assigned value as 10. So 10 plus 2 will get added, and totally that 12 value will get assigned to this x variable in the left hand side. Okay. So this is what the concept is. Understanding this, this is the straight way of doing such kind of an assignment. The same thing can also be done. Look at here, students. This is the point that I am trying to explain now. The same thing can also be done by writing x. Okay. See, look at here. This plus symbol, which is placed after the equal, can also be written in this side. Okay. Can also be placed in this side. So after that, we can write a equal symbol. Then after that, we can write a this 2 in this place. So it is just the reduced format of the same expression only, but it is the shrinked format of this expanded form of the expression. Okay, so this can be expanded and written as, this can be expanded and written as x is equal to x plus 2. Okay, those who are seeing for the first time, it may look strange for them, but this is only the meaning behind this compound assignment, plus equal to 2. Getting this? Fine, students. Good. So I have used only plus symbol just before the equal. Okay. So now I wish to ask you one question. X, I can very well write a star denoting a multiplication. With that, I will write a 5. Now, what is the value of x? Okay. X is, take the same value, x is assigned with the 10. Okay. The meaning for this expression is, let me tell the expanded format of this expression. The meaning for this is x is equal to x into 5. That is an expanded form of this expression. Okay. Always in our real-time programming experience, in our real-time examples, we will not use this expanded format. We will maximum find programs done like this complex format only. Okay. So it is our duty to understand that this is nothing but a compound assignment, which means x gets repeated on the right hand side as well, like this. So if this is the case, x value will now become 10 into 5, that is 50. Getting this? Understanding this? So this is what an assignment operation is. This is a syntax. Basically, we will write a variable, that is x. In the taken example, we have written x, and then we can also write an expression that will evaluate to a value. Okay. We can also write an expression. So for example, x is equal to a plus b. X is equal to a plus b, which means a has got some value and b has got some value. They both get added, and that particular value will be stored with the x. That is the meaning. Okay. And then we need to end with a semicolon. Okay. These are all the various examples for that expressions. Getting the students? Everything clear? So basically, it performs an arithmetic operations and then assign that that expression value to the left hand side variable, nothing else. Now look at here, in this slide, what I have explained here is, in the previous slide, I was explaining about a simply two operators, that is a plus and a star. The same thing, look at it here. Take the first example, a equal to a plus 1. So instead of writing this in a straight manner, it can also be written as a plus equal to 1, which means it gets expanded, and the meaning is a equal to a plus 1 only. Okay. A similar way, we need not stick to only plus and star operator. We can use any other multiplication, arithmetic, or modulo division or simply division operators like this. Okay, instead of minus representing a minus 1, we can also represent it as like this. Similarly, multiplication operator, similarly division, modular divisions, all these things can be done like this. Getting this? Take a look at this, students. Take a look at this. Okay, just it is an example. Okay, it is an example where we are adding the c, sorry, a plus b will be added, and that added value will get multiplied with the c. So look at here. Almost this is what explained in this left hand side also. I am rewriting here. It is nothing but c is equal to c into a plus b. Okay. First, they both get added, and that added value will get multiplied with the c, and together all these computed value will get stored in this c variable. Okay, this is the concept, and this is similarly for the division operator as well. Okay, in a shortened format only we will be using in our programs. Okay, this is the usual notation that we can most predominantly found in the programming examples. Okay. So with this we have completed our this assignment operator, and this is an example program. Let's try to guess the output of this program, students. Okay, guess the output of the program one by one. A is assigned with 11, and the meaning of this line is, let me tell this explanation alone and then I'll ask the question in the next examples. A is assigned with the value 11, and now the meaning of this instruction is A equal to A plus 4. Okay, substitute the value of a in this place, that is 11. 11 plus 4 will get added, that is it becomes 15, and that 15 will be assigned to this variable a. Now when I execute this instruction, value of a equal to, in the place of that, if I bring that value a in this place, it will print me value of a is, what is the value? 15. It will print this one. Okay, now look at here again. A is initialized with 11. A is again initialized with 11. See, previously A was assigned with 11. With that value 4 gets added, so it becomes 15. Okay, now I am reinitializing that 15 with 11. So that is in this place, happened in this place. Now with that 11 we are subtracting A equal to A minus 4. So if this happens, this 11 is subtracted with the 4. If this happens, we will get the subtracted value here, and that value will get printed in this place. Value of A is value of A is 7. This is 7. Okay. Now once again, now presently value of A becomes 7. Now once again I'm reinitializing it with 11 as per this instruction. Now with this instruction a is equal to 11, I am simply again doing a equal to a into 4, which means already a has got 11. With the 11 we are multiplying with the 4, so if you are multiplying with the 4 it becomes 44, and that 44 will get stored in the variable a itself. Okay, now at this time a print value of a is 44 in this place. It will print 44 in this place. Now once again a is assigned with the variable 11, and now 11, look at here, it is interesting. Look at here, a is assigned with the value 11. Okay, now as per this a slash equal to 4, as per this line the meaning is a equal to a by 4. That is the meaning of this instruction. That is a, that is 11 divided by 4. Okay, a is a variable of integer. A is a variable of integer, which means it is capable of storing only a round number, not a number with the fractions. It is dividing now 11 by 4. So by dividing 11 by 4 we will be able to exactly divide only 12 nearer to this number. Okay, lesser than this 11 we have got only 2 times. Okay, 2 times it can reach up to 8. Okay, remaining 3 will be means remaining 3 is a remainder. Okay, if you want to successfully divide that, we have to use a semi fractions. If I use a fraction, 3 0 will come, and in the fourth table we will be getting 28 near about 30. Okay, and again there will be a remainder of a 2, and if we divide that remainder by 4, means 20 divided by 4, we will get 5 times. So this is the exact division that we will be getting as an answer for a by 4. But a is capable of storing only an integer, so simply it will discard this 0.75 and it will store only 2 to the variable a. Why? Because integer a has got only integer. A is declared as an integer only. Okay, look at in this place, print value of a in this place, it will print only 2. Okay, again now for the sake of understanding, for having a strong understanding only, it is repeatedly given like this. Again a is assigned with the 11, and then this compound assignment is given, that is a it is equivalent to a equal to a modulo division 4. Okay, the value of a is 11 modulo division 4. Okay, so concept of modulo division is whenever we divide, whatever remainder we are getting, that is the answer for this modulo division. So 3 times, sorry, not 3 times, 2 times we can able to have a 8. The remainder for this particular subtraction is 3. So the answer will be 3 in this place. So a will get a 3 stored in it. So this a will print 3 as the output. So look at here. All the outputs that we have shown, everything is displayed here. Fine, students. So last topic is the bigwise and the size of operator. This is the last topic we need to study in this first unit, and after this we are about to study one more topic called storage classes. Let's take this topic. It is very simple topic. Okay, bitwise operator. There is a bitwise operator called, look at here, bitwise operator called ampersand, this kind of a pipe symbol, and then cap symbol. Okay, this denotes bitwise and. I am writing very shortly, bit and. Okay, most probably you might have studied in digital technology that the logical operations takes place like a bitwise and, bitwise or, bitwise XOR, bitwise XNOR, like that. So many operations you would have studied. The same thing applies here as well. It takes only a single bit into its account for doing its operation. It will do only a single bit for its operation. Okay, it is an XOR, bit XOR. Okay, XOR. Okay, the meaning of this is, okay, let's take a p value. See, look at this table, students. Look at this table. This is an examples only. All these are examples. Okay, if in case p value is a 0 and q value is also 0, then when we do and between this bitwise and between these two values, the output also will be 0. Okay, and means 0 gets AND with the again 0, we will get a 0 as the output. Okay, 0 when we does, which means when we do bitwise addition, this is a single pipe symbol, this is called as a pipe symbol. Okay, pipe, this is called as a pipe symbol. So when we do addition of 0 plus 0, again also we will get 0 only as the output. Okay, and similarly XR, when we do XR between 0 and another 0, we will get a 0 as the output. Okay, now go for the other chances of having P as a 0, but this time Q is a 1, made to 1. Okay, so just we are assuming for two values of this P and Q, what are the outputs of other values. Okay, when we do AND of the 0 with 1, so whenever we do, it is somewhat similar to our multiplication only. Okay, whenever we multiply any number with a 0, what is the result of it? 0 only. Okay, whenever there is a 0 comes and we try to do some any big number multiplied with this 0, automatically blindly you can close your eye and then you can write the result as 0. So same applies here as well. So AND of 0 and 1 will give the result as 0. But 0 plus 1, look at here, 0, with that if we add 1, the result is 1. Okay, that's why this result is here like this. Okay, XOR, I'll explain this XOR little bit later. Now you listen up to this AND and OR. Okay, there is one interesting point in this XOR. Look at here, I have finished up to this. Now when we do AND of both P as well as a Q as 1, okay, when you are doing multiplication between 1 into 1, when you do a multiplication of this 1 into 1, you will get the result as 1. So that is why we have got the result as 1 here in this place. So similarly, when we try to add 1 with 1, logic or logic 1 with the logic 1, we will get a logic 1 as the output. Okay, do not take directly 1 plus 1 in terms of decimal numbers. Okay, do not take it in that point of view. It is only a single bit. Okay, in case if you wish to do a decimal kind of a calculations, you have to do a decimal calculations, and after that you need to convert that into a binary form, and then you can write, you have to write that one in this place. Okay, never get into such kind of complex things. One logic one or logic high, as well as another operand value is also logic high. When both are getting added, we will get the output as logic high. Okay, that is the meaning of this one. Okay, now again, one operand is 1, another operand is 0. When we multiply both of them, again we will get a 0 as the output. But here R operator 1 plus 0 will give output as 1. Okay, now come to this XOR operator. XOR operator, see, sir, how sir to remember this XOR operator very quickly? Look at here, I am erasing everything. Okay, see, whenever there is two operands P and Q, whenever two operands values are same, whenever P and Q operands value are same, at the time everything, it will become 0. It will become 0. Look at here. Here both the operands values are 0, identical. And similarly here also, they both operands values are identical. Whenever they both are identical, operand result will become 0. But whenever something is different, whenever something is different, their output will be 1, logic 1. Okay, in this manner you remember this one. So this is the output of the bitwise operator. Okay, let's take an example. I have taken only a single example here. Let's take A is with the value 60 and B is with the value 13. Convert this into a binary format like this. Convert this into a binary format. Whether you have come across this kind of a concept of converting a decimal into binary format, students? Have you studied this? Do you want to explain that? Do you want to explain that? How to convert this decimal number into binary format? Simply divide it by 2 and write the remainder. What is the remainder?
Yes, sir.
Nothing. Nothing is the remainder. Okay, it exactly divides the 60. So like this, I hope it is, you might have studied. Simply I'll do only this thing. So what is this? No remainder now also. Now at this time, it becomes 7 to 14. We will get a remainder 1. And if we further divide it by 2, simply we need to stick to division by 2 only, not anything else. Okay, because we want to convert this decimal number 60 into a binary number only. Okay, so now also again it gives a number, remainder as 1. And again, if we divide it by 2, we will get a remainder as 1. One time we can get 2, but remainder is 1. So now we have to collect all these numbers in the reverse format. In the reverse format, we have to write 1, 1, how many ones? 4 times ones. Okay, 4 times ones, and last 2 zeros are there. Okay, so this is what written, but by grouping the 4 digits together and another 4 digits together. Here we didn't have any number, so we can simply enhance it by adding or appending a further 2 times 0. So this is what written here. Okay, this is what written here. So now similarly, 13 will also be divided by each time 2, and then the corresponding equivalent binary is written here. And now we are trying to do a bitwise AND here, bitwise AND here. Okay, so 0 AND with 1, we will get a 0. 0 AND with 0, again we will get a 0. But when both the operands are same, that is identical, 1 and 1, if we are multiplying with 1 and 1, we will get the output as 1. So similarly here also 1 and 1, 1. In all other places, here everything is a 0. So 0 multiplied with any number is a 0 only. Okay. So like this, the operations will be executed by using a bitwise operator. Sir, why sir all these things are used? We will be using this in the while we are executing or while we are writing a programs for some big complex programs, at the time we will use these logics and all. Okay. We will use this ampersand. We will suddenly use this pipe symbol. We will suddenly use this cap like symbol. It is actually an XOR symbol. Okay. So at the time you should not get panic. These are all the operators of our bitwise.